Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and this week it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 20th Century Fox, 1941. We'll be discussing I Wake Up Screaming, otherwise known as Hotspot, and Confirm or Deny. Later on, we'll be doing Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. It's going to be an extended segment this time out because we saw three movies at the TIFF Lightbox this week. On Tuesday night, we saw Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, and then yesterday, Saturday, we saw two movies with a 5-hour break in between, The Palm Beach Story and Melody of Murder, a Danish noir. So stay tuned for that. Before we get into our films, let's take a look at Joel W. Findler's list of contract stars at 20th Century Fox in 1941. This is from The Hollywood Story. And as always, these star ratings and even these choices, they appear to be based on his opinion or his impression of the star's value to the studio throughout the length of their contract. Carmen Miranda. Two stars?
Two stars for Carmen Miranda.
I think we talked about that last time. She was basically the highest paid star in Hollywood during the 40s, but on the other hand, she never really carried a movie. She was a specialty act. I don't know, I would have given her 3 stars.
But I guess I have dementia here, so regular listeners may already have absorbed this.
It was a while back, so I'm sure you've all forgotten what we said in Fox 1940. Dana Andrews, 2 stars. Anne Baxter, 2 stars. Betty Grable, 3 stars. Jean Tierney, 2 stars. Alice Faye, 3 stars. Henry Fonda, 3 stars. Sonia Haney, 2 stars. Don Ameche, 2 stars. Tyrone Power, 3 stars. And Linda Darnell, 2 stars.
And no Victor Mature?
No, that seems like a serious oversight because I don't know exactly when he came on board as a full-fledged member of the Fox player list, definitely in other Fox movies throughout the decade.
We can find that out on his Wikipedia page. It says that Fox bought out half of his contract with Hal Roach. He'd been appearing in movies with Hal Roach Studios.
Yes, including 1 Million BC, which was a giant hit from out of nowhere.
And then by the time this movie appeared, the same month, November 1941, Fox bought out the rest of the contract.
Interesting. I don't know why he's not in here, because he should be. You know, he's in a bunch of Fox noirs. He's in My Darling Clementine.
This is now the TCM Notes, my other favorite place to go to. Jean Renoir was considered as a director, and so was Ruben Mamoulian.
But then they went with old reliable H. Bruce Humberstone, who is a B-movie pro.
Charlie Chan.
Yeah.
This seems to have possibly been his greatest cinematic accomplishment, I Wake Up Screaming.
And it is no mean achievement. I'm really impressed with this movie. Before we start discussing it, let's hear what Tony Thomas and Aubrey Solomon had to say in the films of 20th Century Fox. A beautiful young girl, Carol Landis, is murdered, and the chief suspect is the man, Victor Mature, who has been promoting her for possible stardom as an entertainer. Her sister, Betty Grable, demands action from the police, and a detective is assigned to the case. None of that is really accurate. The detective, Laird Krieger, is a huge, seemingly amiable but menacing man who hounds the promoter and promises to get him.
He never seems amiable.
He's soft-spoken. I think that's as close as he gets to amiable. But the murderer is the detective himself, incorrect, who had idolized the girl from afar and resented the possibility of sharing her with the world.
That is true. That part's true.
I Wake Up Screaming is a classy suspense picture with a haunting performance by Krager as the pathetic and sinister detective. That is true.
So much misinformation out there in the world. How are we ever to know what is really the case? Well, I guess in this case, you just watch the movie.
That's right. And it is probably easier to see this movie now than it was in 1980 or whenever this was put out. The movie appeared on DVD and I have it, but I don't know whether Thomas and Solomon were able to screen it for this book.
So this is pretty early for a full-blown film noir.
Yeah, it's basically year one of noir. I guess you could make 1940 year one if you want to do Stranger on the Third Floor, but this is, you know, right after that. Same year as Maltese Falcon, and before all of the main ones that were cited by the Cahiers critics.
This is absolutely much more than the Maltese Falcon. This is stylistically a noir, in terms of its visual style. Yeah. And it's sort of milieu, visual milieu.
The Maltese Falcon just has the hard-boiled roots and the dialogue and the cynical take on human nature that you will see in film noir, but as you say, it's not exactly shot in the chiaroscuro lighting, and it's not presented in the way that a full-blown mid-1940s noir will be, but I Wake Up Screaming is.
Yeah, for sure.
So we've got an interesting cast here. Victor Mature and Carol Landis, actually, and I think this is probably pretty important if you're going to consider the way the movie would be received. They had co-starred in 1 Million BC. So Carol Landis was like the cave woman in that movie, which I've never seen, in fact. So I'm just talking out my hat. I might be just as off base as Thomas and Solomon here.
Well, you haven't said anything one way or the other except that it exists.
I think she's a cave woman.
Oh, anyway, I see.
It's okay. 1 million BC.
Right. She's great in this movie.
Yeah, she and Betty Grable play sisters. Moon Over Miami is the same year. That's where they go husband hunting. Carol Landis is one of those really sad Hollywood stories.
Yeah, I was going to say there's at least, like, known to me, two very sad Hollywood stories in this movie.
Yeah. You know, she was definitely on track for big things, just got derailed.
Well, she had an affair with Zanuck, apparently, which I don't think that's anything anyone wants to do.
No, probably not. But then even worse, an affair with Rex Harrison.
Is that the one?
The cad of cads. Their relationship, whatever happened there, precipitated her suicide.
Right. It could have just been his refusal to divorce his wife. This apparently triggered suicide in lots of starlets.
The great Lily Palmer was the wife. We'll be doing an entire actress overview on Lily Palmer. She is much more than the adversary of Carol Landis in the love life of Rex Harrison, but this is one of those Hollywood stories that you hear all the time.
Yeah, she was only 29, and barely any older than her when he died is Laird Krieger.
Right, so Laird Krieger was an amazing character actor, and this is really one of his groundbreaking opportunities. He's also in This Gun for Hire, amazing as the devil in Heaven Can Wait. But what he wanted to do was star in films, be the protagonist, and he did not have the physique, or that's what they always say, right?
He had been on the stage. He played Oscar Wilde on the stage, for one thing. Also appeared in the title role of The Man Who Came to Dinner.
Oh, interesting.
He wanted bigger roles.
So he had a, I guess, starring role, you could say, in The Lodger, but he's Jack the Ripper, basically. So that's not exactly what he wanted. I mean, he made a huge impression there. Hangover Square was the next one, and he had lost a bunch of weight to land that role.
Employed amphetamines for that purpose, and went on a crash diet, and it resulted in abdominal problems, and eventually in a heart attack.
Yeah. At what, 30?
31.
31.
He died.
Rough things in store for a couple of our important players here. We've also got a real change of pace role for Betty Grable. She was fast becoming their most bankable star.
She is so weird looking.
She looks...
I just do not find her facially appealing at all. She does a decent job. I guess she was just likable. It must have been a personality thing that put her over with the GIs.
Yeah, she's extremely likable. Charting Betty Grable's career is fascinating, right? Because she shows up, she was not a big deal. She's in movies throughout the 30s. She's in The Gay Divorcee. We talked about that. She just shows up to do a weird number, a weird dance number with Edward Everett Horton. Let's knock knees. And she's just a complete oddball.
Well, I don't find her that interesting in her movies. Oddball makes her seem more interesting than she is.
But she's really odd in those RKO
sure.
cameos.
Yeah. When you look at her Fox musicals, you would think she couldn't act at all, but she's fine in this role.
Well, she is fine. We're going to talk more about Betty Grable. We've got some of her starring musicals coming up.
She's really, really wooden in some of those Fox musicals.
Well, reserve judgment. You'll see. We're going to watch some more. We're going to have, I think, a Betty Grable double feature in Fox 1942.
I mean, obviously that famous photo of her looking over her shoulders is sort of sexy girl next door energy. I guess that's the idea.
Yeah, this is a great low-key role for Betty Grable. And I think she really does a terrific job selling everything she has to do in this movie. I don't think she lacks anywhere here.
I thought that scene, like when she's being freaked out by the police officers, that was all perfectly serviceable. And that scene where she walks across the apartment and thinking about her dead sister, or that's after her sister actually dies and ends up with the tear in her eye, that worked well.
Yeah.
So this is really a movie of visuals, mise-en-scène. There's even some tricks to it, like tricksy noir tricks, like extra diegetic music turns out to be diegetic music. That's also in the death scene, I believe, or the body discovery scene.
Really makeshift score, which I think people always talk about, right? That's part of the low budgetness of this film. They keep going back to street scene and Somewhere Over the Rainbow. So nothing was really written for this movie in terms of score. I think they just shoehorned stuff in.
Yeah, I thought I recognized that opening number with the credits.
But the sound design at times is incredible, right? When Laird Kreger first appears, when she sees him out of the corner of her eye through the plate glass window, those ominous rumblings, that whole audiovisual moment is matchless. It just unsettles you immediately. And, you know, she's telling it as a disturbing story and it lives up to it.
So the cinematographer here is Edward Kronjager. So let's see what else he did. Nothing is really standing out for me in this filmography.
He seems to have shot several of the Technicolor Fox extravaganzas, including The Gang's All Here, which is the most outré of them all.
Also, Heaven Can Wait was a major film.
Western Union, a Fox Western directed by Fritz Lang.
He's just a Fox guy.
But that did allow him to do a bunch of interesting things.
He doesn't seem to have been a noted cinematographer, but yeah, again, you have to ask yourself, doing this series really makes me question auteur theory, because so many astonishingly sophisticated movies are made by no one particular of note. People who were just journeymen. Talked about that a lot with, particularly in the 1940s, Hollywood style just really reaches an apex. And it's utterly mysterious how this happened, why it all happened at once. And I mean, obviously once it starts happening, everyone's copying it.
Yeah, but this isn't copying anything. That's the fascinating thing, right? It's setting the trend.
It had to be. Like, who was coming up with this idea?
H. Bruce Humberstone and Edward Kronjager.
They had to be basing this on something.
German Expressionism.
That's what I was going to say. But again, why German Expressionism at this exact moment?
It's hard to say. I mean, Fritz Lang was hanging around at the studio.
That's true. I don't know, it almost makes you think that Fox had some kind of agenda going on. Although, who would have set this agenda? I don't know. Some kind of agenda of moving in a German Expressionist direction. Again, though, this is not really German Expressionism, though, because it's so importantly American urban.
Yeah. I think this is a unique contribution to the cinema made by some people that are just not celebrated.
Yes, it's all very mysterious. How these genre trends get started, who gets the credit for them, how much genius is really required in an individual to create a stylistically outstanding movie. At this point, when you did just have all these craftsmen just sitting around in the studios making B-movies, right? Yeah. To just slap together a brilliant cinematic work, the genius of the system, but not the way that book talks about it.
Not the way, no, not Thomas Schatz-wise, no. The film is based on a novel by Steve Fisher. He's an author I've always been interested in reading, but I never have. He wrote the screenplay for Lady in the Lake.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And he was a big pulp novelist.
Black Mass contributor.
Yeah. Somehow I just haven't ever taken the time to read one of his own books, but I do want to, and I'll probably try reading this one as soon as I can.
So obviously, both the hard-boiled detective novelists and Black Mask were very much contributing to the creation of film noir.
Oh, yeah. Well, this is the literary side, the literary feeder for all of the stories that are going to be told in the 40s.
Although, again, it's odd because these stories, these novels, or at least this magazine and these novels had been around for a long time already.
Sure, well, they start in the 20s.
Of course, everyone attributes the new mood to America being about to enter the war, and the fact of the war going on
right
in Europe.
Both of our movies are from toward the end of 1941, and the U.S. enters World War II on December 7th, 1941, a day that will live in infamy. We'll talk about that more with Confirm or Deny, I'm sure.
What do we have? What are all the different milieus that mingle in this movie? We have boxing promotion. Later on, we get a little picturesque tour of Victor Mature's old neighborhood.
The Lower East Side, yeah.
It's sort of like a fairy tale version of a 30s Warner Brothers movie. Then we have the world of glamorous nightclubs.
Very important if you're going to make your name in the city.
We have our three fellows at the beginning who get this plot started. Our Mature, the promoter, originally of boxers, but also now of It Girls, I guess.
Alan Jocelyn is the Broadway columnist, like the Walter Winchell kind of guy. And Alan Mowbray is a has-been actor. And the three of them just happen to be dining at this low-rent restaurant, and they decide that Carol Landis has it. I mean, this is a flashback, of course, right? Because we start right away with Victor Mature getting the third degree from the New York City cops.
So just, Alan Mowbray actually had a thriving career.
Oh yeah, he's great.
So what's he doing in this Fox B movie?
I don't think he had a studio contract. He's just everywhere. Anytime they need a guy with a sense of humor who can play a has-been. He often gets enlisted for that kind of role, but he can do a lot of sophisticated comedy as well. He plays William Powell's best friend from the old rich days in My Man Godfrey. Mm. That's a significant role for him. He turns up everywhere. And Alan Jocelyn is a great actor, too. We've seen him a fair bit lately.
So Carol Landis is also very good in this movie.
She is. Playing, yeah. She's dead before the movie starts.
Like a kind of Laura Palmer
a little bit
figure.
Yeah, exactly.
Only in the fact that people are obsessed with her and she dies, but...
Yeah, she dies before the movie starts.
Yes.
So we only see her through flashback.
That's true. And she is quite schizophrenic in those flashbacks. A lot of people see her in different moods and in different ways.
So again, it doesn't only have the visual stylings and the murder plot. It has also the fractured narrative that we associate with film noir. It's got all of it.
Starts out with police interrogation, moody chiaroscuro police interrogation.
Yeah.
And it's got the, particularly in contrast to the Nordic noir that we saw that we're going to discuss later, it has the element right from the start of the police being corrupt. So really, other than the absence of a femme fatale or a hard-boiled detective, those narrative elements aren't there, but a lot of noir narrative elements are, as well as all of these visual signifiers. And yeah, structural, as you say, signifiers.
So these guys decide together they're going to put over Carol Landis as a major new personality in the New York upper crust. And so they set about doing it. We hear about all of this as they retell it.
She's a hard-boiled waitress originally in the flashback.
Yeah, she doesn't take them seriously at first, but eventually she has to realize that, yeah, these are famous guys, or they know famous people, and they're going to make me famous or try.
And she does a very good job at her upper crust impersonation.
And she immediately starts getting requests for endorsements, all kinds of nifty opportunities, and decides that she's going to quit her job at the restaurant.
Betty Grable, her girl next door sister, skeptical, too smart to have her head turned in this way.
She says, you gotta watch out. These people are gonna use you up and throw you away. But Carol Landis says, no, look, we're different. I'm sorry, I have to go for this. And it turns out she's right.
Yeah, so that doesn't turn out to be the problem with what happens to her.
Now, these guys are intending to use her for their own purposes, and they're pretty frank about that, but not in any more callous a way than anyone else in a capitalist system. They're not unusually brutal with her or anything.
Well, on the contrary, she finds somebody, like, a better offer than these guys have.
Exactly, exactly. So that's what they're a little hacked off about. They get halfway through their plan to make her the Queen of New York, and she takes a Hollywood offer and plans to leave immediately after telling them. The person who's the most chagrined is Alan Mowbray, because he gets hurt the worst. He is washed up, or feels washed up, as a man and as an actor, and he's starting to feel his ancient oats. once again, and those hopes get dashed. She doesn't take him seriously as a romantic object.
Or
and,
as a romantic lead.
Well, exactly. He sets up an audition for the two of them to play a scene for some Hollywood people, and she just goes without him, lands herself a contract, and Mowbray is stuck stewing in his own sadness. So the movie is definitely setting you up for thinking, okay, well, maybe this is the guy that killed her, right? There's a lot of interesting misdirection in the film. So much misdirection that Tony Thomas and Aubrey Solomon get the killer wrong in their write-up. Of course, we do all spoilers all the time here.
I wish you hadn't told me that thing about Elisha Cook Jr. being so weird in this movie, because that spoiled the murderer for me.
Well, he didn't necessarily have to be the murderer.
Of course he did, because he's barely in the film. So if you were going to, like, he shows up for 2 seconds at the beginning and then at the end. So obviously that notified me that he was the killer, since he didn't have any screen time for most of the movie.
That's true. I'm sorry.
And by the way, his character is not one quarter as weird as in Born to Kill, so I'm still right about that.
He's a real strange character, though. In the remake, which is great as well, it stars Gene Peters and Gene Crane. That character is played by Aaron Spelling before he went on to create The Love Boat and other TV programs.
So we know from the beginning that Laird Krigar's character, I think we completely buy Betty Grable as a reliable point of view character. They keep casting aspersions on her, or casting skepticism on her point of view, because her sister said she was in love with Victor Mature, which she admits, and we do believe that that's the case. But I don't think the film ever pushes you toward thinking that he could be the killer and that she's wrong about him. So when she gives her description, and as you say, it's an incredibly creepy scene of Laird Krigar's stalking of her sister, I think we, right from the beginning, do believe that there's something very wrong with this guy.
Yeah.
Who's also trying to, like, he's just taunting and bullying Victor Mature's character the whole time. Their interactions are one of the main features of the film, for sure. But we also get the hinted backstory that he does this all the time, or explicit backstory that he does this all the time. Maybe not this obsessively and intensely, but he is always hounding these murderers, and he's always right about who is the murderer. So that, again, I don't think we're ever meant to believe that could be Victor Mature, but at the same time, it's hard to understand narratively how they're going to get out of it being Victor Mature because of all of this other information that we learn.
Because he's such a brain genius.
Yes, Larry Krigar, yes.
There's such an interesting echo of Inspector Javert in Les Misérables here, where it just seems like he is the one, he's the automaton who is thinking 10 steps ahead, no one else understands. I mean, I guess echoes too of Sherlock Holmes and a bunch of other intuitive genius detectives. But it turns out that in this case, he's completely lying. He's got his own agenda. And maybe in many of the other cases too, who knows? Maybe he railroaded and killed several people he just didn't like. We just don't know by the end what is going on.
Or was he completely destroyed? His mind was just destroyed by Carol Landis.
Yeah, that's how it seems. To me, he plays it because he does have such a pathos to him, right? That he's always been a guy who just lived entirely for the thrill and the intellectual challenge of solving these murders, and he does it on his own time as well. And then he gets the money back when he brings in the murderer with the inescapable proof. But once he met Carol Landis, he just got knocked off track. He couldn't stop following her, and he gets his chance to rescue her from some toughs, some mashers.
So I guess in a way, she's the femme fatale of the movie, even
but
though...
inadvertently.
Inadvertently, but that's also true of Laura.
Well, sure.
It's a
yeah.
Fox staple. And again, Fox does that again with Linda Darnell's character in...
Fallen Angel.
Apparently, Dave, the film that Krigar was scheduled to make right before his death was an adaptation of Les Misérables.
As Javert?
It doesn't say.
It makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Although I guess he could have played Jean Valjean too. Why not?
This is the movie for which he was trying to lose so much weight that he killed himself.
Halfway through, or less than halfway through, it gives you kind of, it solves the mystery and then unsolves it, which is another fascinating gambit, right? They say, okay, we're going to have to let you go because we've pretty much figured it out. It's the switchboard operator weirdo played by Elisha Cook Jr. And everyone thinks, okay, well, that's fine. But Laird Krigar doesn't go along with that. And we find out just how much he doesn't go along with that at the very end of the movie. But it seems like, you know, there's enough of a respite here where Victor Mature and everyone else, Betty Grable, can try to find their bearings and get on with their lives post-Vicky. But then, all of a sudden, Alicia Cook Jr. is back at his switchboard desk. He's not the murderer, we're told, because he has an alibi. He was off in Brooklyn, and he just didn't know anyone was looking for him. To me, that scene is weird enough. Betty Grable goes home. She wants to move. She doesn't want to live anymore in the apartment she shared with her dead sister. And Alicia Cook Jr. is like, yes, I packed everything for you. And she looks at him like, what the fuck are you doing, bro? Earlier in the film, we had seen him in a brief flashback where he was just lazing around at his switchboard desk and did not jump to the order to get Carol Landis's key, and Victor Mature has to kick him in line. Here, he's extremely attentive to Betty Grable. It's a very odd whiplash effect. We know there's something really off with this guy, right?
Well, he's played by fucking Alicia Cook Jr.
Yeah, this is the same year as Maltese Falcon, where he plays Wilmer, where there's something really, really off
with him. Has he ever done anything else?
The occasional admirable character, like Little Jonesy in The Big Sleep, who everyone agrees is a wonderful man, and he's just been led astray by Agnes, who's right. Too big for him.
Sarcastic Agnes.
Yeah, just the invasion of privacy. And the movie just makes you feel that he was groping her panties while he put things in the suitcases.
Yeah, that kind of movie.
And she looks at him, but then she's like, all right, well, since you did it, thanks. Can you get me a cab? I want to get out of here right now.
So much of this movie is the pleasures of the visuals of the diner with its picture window where the waitresses are put on display to entice customers inside, I guess.
Yeah, well, that's what Carol Landis says, right? That plate glass window, you just get used to looking like you're on the menu.
And it works. It entices and leads Laird Kragar astray.
Yeah, knocked off his path, his incel path. He could have just stayed on it and solved crimes.
I guess he was always too hyper-focused on the crime-solving to have a relationship. That must be where he went wrong.
Well, he's also just a really fucked-up dude, as we saw, right? He talks about how he followed her, he just watched her from the shadows, chose his moment, and what did he get out of it? A brief coffee date with her, and he was working his way up to asking her for more, and what he says is he wanted to ask her to marry him.
Well, he sets up this apartment for her.
Yeah, and he really gets ahead of himself.
Well, he believes that, as a waitress, that she would eventually have to succumb to this, that she would realize this is the best deal that she's going to get. She's going to become his own backstreet mistress.
No, he's going to marry her.
Well, he just set up an apartment for her, though.
No, but he wants to live there with her, right? Because he was living in some kind of seedy rat trap before, so he gets an apartment so he can share it with his wife-to-be.
How is he making such a poor salary that he's living in a seedy rat trap?
He's a guy who doesn't think about such things, right?
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Because that's what he says at the end.
He's like, an ascetic.
Well, I started to feel really self-conscious about having this apartment that I only got because I wanted to lure her in and be my wife here, and that's not going anywhere.
He sold that so well.
Yeah.
That final speech that I started wondering. I actually got on his side, and I started wondering,
what would have happened?
Could this really have been true? Could she have decided this obsessive freak is the best deal I'm going to get? I mean, we see enough of her personality to think maybe it's possible. She doesn't have the most pleasant personality. She is trying to get ahead and not be a waitress her whole life. And if she's gone on dates with this guy, I guess no major alarm bells went off.
She was clearly friend-zoning him, right? That's how he put it. And he was really trying to work his way up to taking things to the next level, but wasn't happening.
Why would you be friends with this guy?
Because he helped her and he's a policeman. I mean, it's a good person to know, I imagine. Especially if you're being accosted by hooligans in the street when you leave the diner at 2 a.m. every night.
I guess. Well, unless he turns out to be a creep as well.
That's right. Well, that's the problem, right? With the white knight often has his own problems.
Thank you, internet.
Through it all, we get to know Victor Mature quite well as he and Betty Grable get to know each other. So she's initially very resistant, you know, in the flashback. She's like, okay, this guy, you know, you can't trust these guys. This Frankie Christopher, he's just going to use you and throw you away. But she clearly starts to feel differently about him to the point where Carol Landis accuses her of being in love with Frank. Thank you, Christopher.
And Victor Mature is like, that thought has never crossed my mind. And Carol Landis says something like, that's the problem. It's deeper than that.
Yeah.
You don't know what's going to happen.
And so he's a devil-may-care guy, and you really do get the sense he hasn't thought much about anything except for hookups and promoting people. That's his life. But that something more substantial develops between him and Betty Grable as they have their nocturnal adventures.
Turns out he's just a boy next door at heart.
He is. Victor Mature, he's not a person who's given much credit as an actor. I just think he's amazing. Perfect for this role. I mean, he is a suave guy. When it's time for him to be real and talk about who he really is, Frankie Botticelli changed his name because Christopher's easier to pronounce. You know, he really sells that too. There's nothing artificial about his performance here. It gives you everything you need. You're supposed to be on his side even though everyone's accusing him of murder the whole time.
He does a nice sort of hate flirt dance with Laird throughout the whole movie.
Yeah.
And then there's this whole unexpected sequence of Betty Grable doing some real girl power action heroine stuff, despite the fact that that's the last thing you would expect in a 1941 film, including it's not normal in a film noir. She saves him from Laird Kregar.
Laird Kregar is about to take him in.
I just like saying it Kregar. I just have to say that for some reason. Laird Kregar. It's not right, but...
He's about to take him in because they've got this letter that he wrote. Frankie wrote this letter saying it's better for you to get out of the way as soon as possible. I mean, again, we understand what it's all about because we've seen the flashback to the weird drive where Carol Landis just can't resist making everyone uncomfortable in the car. Okay, if you're gonna ditch us all, just go. Go to Hollywood. Would get out of here, right? That's all he meant. But it could be construed as a threat, and Laird Kregar definitely wants to use it that way. And Betty Grable's like, okay, no, this is going to be a race against time where Victor Mature is going to have to do something to prove his innocence, so I better knock the policeman out.
So this is a twist that you don't normally see on the passive noir hero. He's very much a passive hero through this whole thing. Mm-hmm. He's being bullied by Laird Kregar the whole time, but you don't usually see a good girl love interest who literally rescues him.
Yeah, she gets really involved. She knocks him out, misleads the other policemen, and eventually they have a meetup at an all-night adult movie theater.
Well, first of all, she's sawing his handcuffs off, too.
Yeah, exactly. She thinks of everything.
There's some hardware store.
Well, it's the basement of the apartment, I think.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, I think it's like the janitor's office. Mm. You can get a hacksaw in there.
So she comes up with that idea, too. Yes, so this all-night movie theater where they see... That was pretty hilarious, too. This implication that they're at a porno.
Pretty much, yeah. I guess a 1940s porno. Because, yeah, it does say adults only.
And she's really bored by it.
Sure, well, nobody seems to be too interested. Everyone's just sleeping. It's
so that's seedier than even the noir genre normally gets in the 1940s.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're just this sweet couple hiding out at this porn movie.
But she's got her feet up on the chair in front of her, and the cop comes in and knocks her feet off.
Tells her to put her shoes on.
Yeah. They make a plan, which is to run away. He's going to go get some money he has squirreled away in a safety deposit box, and they're just going to take a powder, go to another town, try to change their names, get away from Laird Kregar. They get thwarted in that because the cops get her. And then Laird Kregar has his theories about butterflies, which he tells the police chief about. The very irritated police chief who's like, get to the point. Why are you telling me about butterflies? So the idea is if you let Betty Grable go, she'll attract Victor Mature back to her and they'll capture Mature.
Victor Mature does show up and holds him up with the Tootsie Roll.
Yeah. Now, there's all kinds of wonderful little moments in this. It's never a dull moment. I really love this movie.
Who are our screenwriters here?
Well, Dwight Taylor was...
Some Astaire and Rogers movies.
Yeah, exactly.
Again, not something you associate with film noir.
Important set piece is when they go for their swim at this all-night swimming pool.
Right.
It's amazing.
Well, this is part of his whole childhood story about how he couldn't afford to swim there when he was a kid, so now he goes there all the time. And of course, this is all an excuse to show off that they're both of their figures.
Yeah, Victor Mature, that's what he was known for, right? For being, he plays Samson and Delilah later. And
Beefcake and Cheesecake.
And Betty Grable, yeah. I mean, her legs were insured for $1 million or whatever, so we know all about that. So yeah, that's during the brief period where he's not wanted by the cops.
Of course, Betty Grable isn't that Betty Grable yet.
Well, she is. She's getting to be that because she had starred in some musicals already.
They haven't entered the war yet, though, so she hasn't actually done the famous pinup.
No, that's right. She's not the pinup girl yet, but she's already a big bankable star for Fox because of the Technicolor musicals, which are getting started. They started in 1940 for her.
So to bring the plot to a close...
Well, they find out that Alicia Cook Jr. really is the killer.
Too many creeps to all be responsible for this murder.
And Laird Kregar knew it the whole time and just said, okay, no, I understand. Don't worry about it.
But Victor Mature took her away from me, and not even because he was having sex with her, because that is established that that didn't happen. Maybe in the story that's the motive, but...
Well, yeah, it's hard to say. Victor Mature gets a chance to explain how he felt about Carol Landis, which is that she was a meal ticket. She was someone he was promoting, just like a boxer, and that's it. He didn't feel that way about her.
But it's also established earlier that he did try to sleep with her, and she wasn't into it.
Those scenes between those three guys are really interesting, too, because they're all trying to, on the one hand, being very vulnerable with each other, talking about how they all failed to sleep with her, right? But on the other hand, they're all kind of talking locker room talk. Like, of course, that's what we should be. We should have been trying to do, right?
Well, I guess Ellen Mowbray actually was.
Yeah, Ellen Mowbray really was. And Ellen Jocelyn, turns out, she probably liked him the best, right? As we find out, they have a more serious kind of heart-to-heart, and he pledges to give her flowers every day for 2 weeks, and he does it by sending them to her grave.
This is an apparent clue that Betty Grable finds, but it does lead to a real clue.
Yeah, and we get a brief interlude with the cemetery night watchman, Frank Orth, always a delightful character actor as well. He's sitting there eating pizza, happy to talk to anyone that comes along in the middle of the night at the graveyard.
So it's a real feature of Fox Noirs. Of course, the only other two I'm very familiar with are the Preminger, Laura, and Fallen Angel, but it's certainly true of Fallen Angel as well as this movie, that often the people in them are very sweet. There's a lot of very sweet people in the movies, as well as a lot of very sick and fucked up people. And the law is never to be trusted, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, another big one is Kiss of Death, which is Victor Mature, a very sweet ex-con, being bedeviled by Tommy Udo.
Now that's a weird character.
Yeah, well, we're going to be doing that one eventually. A lot of texture to these Fox noirs.
Visually stunning.
They really brought a very distinct approach to the noir. And it really all starts here. There's no doubt about that.
Well, as far as we know, little unknown noir you can still discover.
This is the one.
Well, of course, it's not unknown.
Well, now it's known. It's been resurrected. But for many years, it was not thought of as one of the chief proto-noirs or just flat-out noirs.
So I guess I have to say, as far as auteur theory goes, it is true that there are many filmmakers who are geniuses. It is also true that sometimes it really is just the genius of the system, and an equally brilliant movie can be made without one individual being responsible for it, or any particular individual being responsible for it.
Yeah, and in this case, a B-movie, right? Like, so not even the studio functioning at its highest register.
Noir really allowed for that, of course.
Although it is chock full of A-movie stars and character actors.
I guess you could. Someone could go through the work of H. Bruce Humberstone, all those Charlie Chan movies, and maybe make a case for him. I'm not going to do it.
But... Well, we've seen Charlie Chan at the Olympics, which was a pretty good movie, right? The only other movie of his that
I'm just thinking of Ulmer and how people have done that for him, right?
Yeah, the other Humberstone movie I know I've seen is Pinup Girl, the Betty Grable musical. He directed that one. It's not one of the greatest of the Grable movies, but a name to conjure with amongst Grable files. The mystery is solved by the last piece of the flashback puzzle when Ellen Jocelyn tells us how things went for him on the last day. When he was seeing Carol Landis off, he broke into her apartment for her because she didn't have her key, and he noticed the scent of cigarettes in there as he left. And we'd already been told that there were some cigarettes discarded in the closet. Mature and Jocelyn figure out that, okay, well, Elisha Cook Jr. was not at his post. It seems like he must have been waiting in the closet for some purpose.
Waiting in the closet and smoking in her closet.
Yes, that's what he was doing.
Weird.
We get that clue from Laird Krager when he shows up at Victor Mature's place. That's one we didn't talk about. Victor Mature wakes up in the middle of the night and Laird Krager is just sitting there watching him.
That's the closest we get to wake up screaming.
Yeah, it's pretty disturbing.
It's like Bill the Butcher in Gangs of New York.
Yeah, they set up a kind of voice from beyond the grave situation to get Elisha Cook Jr. riled up enough to just confess, and
he
does. He's
pretty easily riled.
He's crazy. There's no doubt. You know, what we learn there is it's really important and interesting. Laird Krager understands what happened with Alicia Cook Jr. because they're the same kind of guy. They get obsessed with a girl from afar. They figure they're not good enough to talk to her or get involved with her, but they want to. And
what if this is the first time he's hidden in her closet?
Yeah. So he pops out of there. He just says, things just went wrong. I just wanted to talk to her and she was going to scream and I panicked and I killed her. And Laird Kreger's like, yeah, I understand, bro. I know.
Well, also he wants to pin this on Victor Mature.
Well, he does, right. But I think it's important that it's the same kind of weirdo guy that commits this murder and for similar reasons. To
one is in a position of much greater power than the other.
But they both understand this feeling of being cut off from romance, right?
Well, certainly heterosexual romance with Carol Landis.
But we do have a happy ending, which doesn't always go hand in hand with the film noir, although it doesn't disqualify it. I mean, Murder My Sweet has a happy ending.
So what I was saying about the niceness of these characters compared to not all, but many other film noirs from other studios may have something to do with continuity within the studios and other genres and just what kind of stars they had on hand, because the continuity is this sweet homespun middle America reputation that Fox had that Ethan Mordden talks about.
19th century Fox.
You know, and it starts with stars like Janet Gaynor, right? And then we get some amount of continuity with that with their musical stars like Betty Grable and Alice Faye in the 1940s. When those are your major stars and you have to put them into other genres, then maybe that ends up sort of warping what it does to the other genres a little bit, right? So obviously the center of redemption within Fallen Angel is Alice Faye's character.
Mm-hmm.
But it even extends to the supposed femme fatale, which is Linda Darnell, right? It radiates outward from the Fox blonde.
Yeah,
but with Laura as well, I mean, the femme fatale is not a femme fatale. And the male murderer is often, certainly not in Fallen Angel, but there's often an element of pathos to him.
Nothing in the Fox noir oeuvre that I can think of that's like Double Indemnity, let's say, where everyone is just a pretty poor figure of a human.
And there's a positive sweetness to it.
We'll keep our eye on that.
But what are some of the other, like, can you think of counterexamples to this? What are some of the other major Fox noirs?
And most of them have a good amount of what you're talking about, with some very likable stars in tough situations, but not the ultra cynical Billy Wilder approach that you get in something like Double Indemnity. Maybe the most calloused of the Fox noirs would be something like Where the Sidewalk Ends. But even there, I mean, Dana Andrews has a serious anger problem, but he's not a diabolical villain, and there's not really a femme fatale.
Well, what are some of the other major noirs that leave a real nasty aftertaste? There's Out of the Past, of course. Jane Greer's character is very awful, and she and Mitchum go to their mutual doom.
Yeah,
and Kirk Douglas isn't any better.
Yeah, I can't really think of any movie that's on that level of cynicism in the Fox noir oeuvre, which is very interesting, and it certainly may have something to do with the stars. I mean, one of the seediest of the 40s noirs is a Fox noir, but even that one is shot through with sweetness, right? Nightmare Alley.
Right, right, of course.
So that's something for us to watch in future Fox episodes, because we do have a bunch of noirs on the docket. We'll see if we continue to agree.
What are some of the major Warner's noirs? The first thing that comes to my mind are all the woman's picture noirs, because that's my all-time ultimate favorite genre. So many of them starring Joan Crawford, but what are some of their noir noirs?
And they didn't do a lot.
Yeah, I don't think they did they?
The Unsuspected is one, which is a kind of a Laura type movie.
Reason I remember the woman's picture noirs is because that's what they were doing for noirs.
Yeah, yeah, and much more so than
almost all of them starring Joan Crawford.
Yeah, more so than the hard-boiled crime noirs that you might see at RKO and Paramount.
All of them starring Joan Crawford? Are there any that aren't starring Joan Crawford? Because obviously I'm thinking about Mildred Pierce, Humoresque, Possessed.
Well, there's the Betty Davis, A Stolen Life. That's a noirish woman's picture.
Garfield, did he make noirs at Warner's? Because he made them elsewhere.
I wouldn't say he made any strictly noir films per se at Warner Brothers, no.
I'm just testing my own theory about Fox noirs being different.
Yeah, well, we're going to put it to the test as we go along, but I think it has plausibility. Onward to confirm or deny. So this one was directed by Archie Mayo, with some background contributions by Fritz Lang. That's according to legend. From our Films of 20th Century Fox, we've got a brief write-up here. Wartime London, with Don Ameche as the head of an American news bureau, and Joan Bennett as a British government teletype operator assigned to see that he does not send any news items out of the country without first checking for permission.
That's not true.
Not necessarily, yeah. I mean, she...
She's not assigned to do that.
She takes on that role, but that's not the reason she's there, no. Together, they spend a lot of time dodging bombs in the Blitz and gradually falling in love, with the hotshot newsman finally becoming more responsible about flashing the news.
I guess you could say that.
Yeah, this is, again, not a responsible report on this film. These guys are like 0 for 20. I mean, I don't think they've ever done a good job of describing any of the movies we've talked about.
So speaking of the stars on hand at Fox, how many starring roles were there for Don Ameche? Like, carrying a whole film roles?
Oh, quite a lot.
Yeah? Because I've mostly seen him being one of several suitors in the Fox musicals.
When he's in movies with Tyrone Power, he's like the other guy. But he had a lot of movies where he was the main male star. Some of them were musicals. Probably his most famous role at Fox, not the best of the movies, although it's an interesting movie, is the story of Alexander Graham Bell. And that's where popular slang, as you might remember from Ball of Fire, when they're talking about, you know, interesting slang, Gary Cooper's character learns that people are calling the telephone the Ameche, because he invented it in the movie, right?
Uh-huh. So Joan Bennett here is heading into her period of stardom, which is strongly linked to noir.
And her changed hair color.
Yeah. Yes, that was important to her period of stardom.
And this may be where she hooked up with Fritz Lang for the first time, or had she already made Manhunt? Because that's the same year.
Well, this movie came out at the very end of the year.
She's going to have one of the most amazing partnerships with Fritz Lang throughout the 40s.
And she had made so many movies before this period starts for her.
Yeah, and we've seen some really interesting ones. Me and My Gal at the early 30s Fox with Raoul Walsh, where she's a fresh Bezoc.
Yeah, that was great.
She plays Amy in Little Women, and again, that's all in her blonde phase.
So in that role, as in this role, she's a real oddball.
Yep.
I don't mean Little Women role. I mean her...
Well, she's pretty odd in Little Women, too.
I mean her Spencer Tracy pairing, which we commented on at the time. She has her very own version of sexual chemistry, which she puts to good use in this movie. She is very, very wry, very, very still, very, very quiet, but has an enormous amount of presence with that.
It's a great meet cute, too, because she just calls him stupid
fool.
From the beginning. Fool, right?
And he is. I mean, that sets up the whole arc of the movie.
He's breaking very important blackout rules, which all of us know. You can't light up a cigarette when the Germans are coming to bomb London.
And he says he was thinking of something else.
He's thinking of something else through a lot of this movie. And he finally gets the picture by the end.
Yeah, in a pretty graphic way. Definitely he has to be taught a major lesson.
Yeah. So this movie came out 4 days after Pearl Harbor?
I don't know. It came out December 12th, 1941.
Yeah, 5 days after Pearl Harbor. They made it before, but very timely release, right? To get Americans thinking even more about their firm ally in the fight against fascism now.
Bennett does a very credible British accent.
Yeah. Don Ameche is not playing a British guy. He's an American.
He's an ugly American.
Foreign correspondent. And we get a sense of the workings of this consolidated press, the president or the guy in charge of this newswire service is Raymond Walburn, who is most familiar to us, I think, from his Preston Strurges outings as Everett, the mayor in Hail the Conquering Hero.
Also, Eric Bloor shows up.
My favorite role for Raymond Walburn is as Dr. Maxford in Christmas in July.
We should talk a bit about the people involved in making this movie, because here we've got some famous names.
Written by Joe Swerling.
Joe Swerling, usually at Columbia. I don't know what he's doing in the 40s, though.
A frequent collaborator with Capra.
Oh, well, he worked on Labor to Heavens. Maybe he's at Fox now.
Yeah, he may have joined the Fox fold.
Well, there's a pretty nasty Fox noir from an unexpected source, John Stahl. But we did talk about how it is, when we're talking about John Stahl, we did talk about how it is an uncharacteristic noir in that normally the femme fatale doesn't kill out of excess of love.
That's right. Yeah. She just loves too much.
It was written by Sam Fuller.
Right. The original story.
Who is a screenwriter at this point. And a war correspondent of both wars, Henry Wales. That's the story.
And the screenplay is by Joe Swirling exclusively, right?
Yeah. They were paid a lot of money, TCM says, $20,000 for this screen story. Close to a record for an original by comparatively unknown writers.
And this was something that Americans were really interested in, even before Pearl Harbor, right? This is London. That's what we're told right at the beginning. And I think that was Edward R. Murrow's sign-on when he was giving reports from blitz-torn London.
Did not know until I looked up Samuel Fuller's biography for this episode. I didn't know that he was spurred to become a director because of Douglas Sirk's direction of his Shockproof screenplay. He was so disappointed. It was like Wilder and Strurges with Lizen.
Well, we're going to be watching that next week.
Shockproof.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Okay. We'll see if we agree with Sam Fuller that he could have done a better job. I'm sure it would be a very different job. They're not totally in other worlds as filmmakers, but Shockproof is an early American Sirk.
Yeah.
So he's not maybe quite fully Sirk yet.
We will see. So Don Ameche's a fast-talking reporter, very familiar figure from all kinds of 30s newspaper comedies. He's the one that gets everything done, and his entire aim is to get the news out, get the scoop, be the most successful news hound that he can be, right?
And he's very pushy and very charming, and of course Don Ameche is very likable.
I love Don Ameche.
It's not the same as if Cary Grant played this role or something. He somehow seems boyishly likable through the entire thing, no matter what he's doing.
Yeah, he's always got this soft side to him. Plays this kind of role fairly often. But yeah, there's always something about him that holds him back from the sheer nihilism of these Cary Grant figures. I mean, Cary Grant
is, of course, very boyishly likable too.
But not always. He can turn that off.
Yeah.
And be just a complete monster if he wants to be.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, I don't think Don Ameche, either he's not trying or he can't. He's just likable. He can't help it.
Yeah, because he certainly could play this character as a complete monster.
Yeah, he doesn't. He doesn't at all.
But he is a complete monster.
Yeah, but we don't feel like he is.
Not until the end.
He has his moment of truth, the confirm or deny.
So this movie slowly builds. You don't really see where this is going.
No.
For sure. And there's a lot of atmosphere in terms of...
What would it be like to live...
Bombed London.
This is London.
Yeah, so we get the sleeping together in the subways, meeting in a blackout, getting your news office bombed out, having to set up shop in a wine cellar.
Of a hotel run by Eric Bloor.
And then also having to accommodate people who have been bombed out of their homes, I guess.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was a pretty big problem. And we're in September 1940. This is just the beginning of an 8-month period of bombardment, right? It doesn't really end until spring or summer of the following year, 1941. So it was over by the time this movie was made. So they're looking back.
Ameche has a couple of people working for him who become important, particularly a little boy.
Well, Roddy McDowall, yeah.
Oh, that's Roddy McDowall?
Yeah.
I missed that.
So this is a big year for Roddy McDowall because he's an incredibly important part of How Green Was My Valley, same year.
Right.
And he even gets to spend some good time with a dog, and that will be important when he appears in Lassie Come Home in 1943. There's Roddy McDowall, the 12-year-old operative who's in charge of listening to news reports coming from Berlin because there's going to be a coded message. And then you've got Mr. Bindle, who is a kind of cockney, middle-aged guy who's waiting on the roof day after day, week after week for these pigeons to arrive with messages from the continent as well.
Where did Ameche get this little boy? Where did he get these people?
It's hard to say. Well, I guess maybe he was like a printer's devil, right? Like an apprentice, and he's been pressed into extra wartime service here. He's very eager to make a contribution.
He is, but of course this is extremely dangerous. He's on top of a roof all day long.
Yeah, but it's dangerous for everybody everywhere in
London. Not if you're in, it's less dangerous if you're in a wine cellar.
That's true. There's Arthur Shields, who's a great actor who plays a blind employee at the Consolidated Press, and he's got sort of extra well-developed hearing, so he can always tell whether the engines above London are Spitfires, which would be the good guys, etc., or whether they're the Luftwaffe ready to drop bombs. At a pivotal moment near the end of the film, he's the one that is like, hey, this bomb is live. It's gonna blow up. And sadly, he gets killed. Now, that's Barry Fitzgerald's brother. Okay. We've remarked on that before. They have different last names.
You have, I guess.
Yeah, I love that actor. He's great. And yeah, so he's a very poignant character as well, because we get to know him just enough to like him quite a lot, and then he gets killed.
Yep.
And we see that quite a few times in this movie. There's a nice little vignette right near the beginning where Amici is just going about his business and he gets the daily casualty list. He's pretty blasé about it, and he's getting it ready to put into his newspaper story. But he notices that a secretary that he likes, because he calls her Red, and every woman he likes, he calls them Red. Or we find that out.
No matter how he likes them, sexually or otherwise.
Yeah, exactly. And whether they have red hair or not, that's not the important thing. He says that he had an Irish setter named Red, and he liked that dog a lot. So he calls women Red. Anyway.
You like dogs and women.
Well, I do.
You've never called me Shelley.
No, Shelley was a wonderful dog.
But so, they both agree her actual name, Jennifer, is stupid.
Yeah, it's just weird, because Jennifer is not a bad name. But I guess Fox 1941 considers it to be just not the best name.
Maybe it was out of fashion briefly.
Well, Jennifer Jones brought it back.
That's true. She's coming soon. Same year, practically.
Yeah.
Which was not her real name at all.
That vignette is quite poignant, right? Where he realizes, okay, the secretary, her husband's on the casualty list. She comes over to get it from him because she's going to set it in type, and he's trying to block her from seeing it. He's got his arm over her husband's name.
Right. He's not utterly callous.
No, he's not. He's just very excited about the news, and he doesn't focus on anything else a lot of the time. But when he is jarred into thinking about other people, he's very nice, as you expect Don Amici to be. And so, yeah, when she notices, you know, he gives her the day off. And yeah, it just really gets you emotionally right off the bat there. And you know there are going to be other people killed. You can just feel it. That's the kind of movie this is going
to
be.
There's a nice sense Archie Mayo manages to get of gravitas building without noticing it, because everything seems so cozy. It's one of those cozy war movies. Weirdly cozy, much like Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds, which was, you know, a tribute to him having experienced wartime bombing as a child.
Yeah, well, Archie Mayo, one of, you know, maybe my favorite movie directed by Archie Mayo is The Petrified Forest, which has a similar doom-laden coziness to it.
Yeah, sure.
So I guess that was a specialty for him. It's a short movie. They cover a lot of important points, but it never feels rushed. It's pretty good. He sort of tries to put the moves on her, and she deflects him, but they like each other. It's pretty clear. But she does tell him that she's married and has 4 kids.
He seems infinitely less mature than she does.
Yeah.
But then they just have such extraordinarily contrasting, I don't even know what you want to call it, personalities. I was going to say acting styles, but it's not really acting styles. It's just their on-screen personalities.
Yeah.
Maybe their actual personalities.
She's very calm, rational. He is very exuberant. But he keeps asking her, you know, where have I seen you before? I know I've seen you before. And it doesn't seem like a line, right? Red is his line or whatever he does. But this seems to be coming from a place of honesty. And she finally tells him that she works at the Ministry of War Information. And of course, he's there all the time. You have to cultivate a good relationship with the Ministry of War Information if you are a foreign correspondent. We've also seen that he has gone to great lengths to set up access to an international cable. Otherwise, they couldn't get their breaking story out. They've paid an exorbitant fee for 1 week of access. They are convinced that this terrifying prospect, the actual invasion of the UK by the Germans, is coming any day now. And that's what the pigeons are going to alert us about. And that is what the radio code is going to be about as well. A very tense time.
But this becomes the major conflict of the movie.
Well, it does, because the things that he's learning are dangerous to broadcast. And of course, for him, it's the news that comes first. Whatever's in the national interest matters a great deal less to him. It's not his nation. He's a reporter. He wants to get the news out to America. So if England thinks it's a bad idea for the Germans to know that the British know that they're coming, they have to suppress it. And we do meet the censor that is sent down to keep an eye on him. That's John Loder, who's also in How Green Was My Valley.
And he just calmly and quietly
censors everything.
Censors all of the good stories.
Yeah. And you know, this is accurate, right? We know now that a huge part of the British success story was the fact that they decoded German messages early in the war, and they managed to keep this a secret. And so they actually had to let some of their people get killed and bombed so that the Germans would keep using the same code. So that if a really, really dire circumstance arose, suppose they would be able to defend against it.
Right.
So these are real problems here that newspapers would have been dealing with. If they learned something that the War Office knew, they still might not be able to broadcast it. So there we get the authentic touch. The story was written by a foreign correspondent, as he said. Most of the rest of it, you know, it comes down to who's going to get killed in these nightly raids. Are we going to have to suffer through the death of little Roddy McDowell?
And is he going to...
And his dog?
I did not think that was going to happen, incidentally.
I thought the dog was going to get killed, but he survives.
But, yeah, and also, is he going to broadcast his story?
Well, of course.
I think, again, like I said, with the increasing sense of gravitas, I don't think we really, certainly I didn't, I don't know what an American audience at the time would have felt, but I didn't get a sense of how important this censorship issue was dramatically until we're near the end of the movie.
Right.
And then it becomes a conflict between him and Joan Bennett. And they've been, up to this point, they've been mostly getting along. Sparks have been flying. You know, he continues to be kind of immature and irresponsible, stealing dresses from other women for her to wear.
Other women he's called Red.
But they seem to be basically progressing toward a possible romance.
Yeah, and she's not actually married. We learn all of that. She's definitely free to get involved, and so is he.
Well, he kisses her.
Yeah.
Once he's got her in that wine cellar with his other employees, he kisses her good morning, and she seems to like that. And
so yeah, it's a really cozy setup there.
They're heading in a good direction. Then all of this comes to a head.
And he's got the special phone line set up to the pigeon roof. The guy that was delegated to wait for the pigeons was injured and is in the hospital. So that's why Roddy McDowell is up on the roof, right? Because that's not his original job. His original job was a safe one, as safe as any job was in London, which is just listen to the radio.
Right.
John Amici doesn't want to send him up there, right? He tries to stop it, but...
It doesn't try that hard.
Well, Roddy McDowell just insists. Please let me do this, please. And he just can't say no to this super patriotic kid. I guess he probably should have, but it's hard. And the movie makes you see that, okay, well, there's no right answer here. He's either going to crush this kid's spirit or he's going to put him in a very dangerous situation.
Well, what it comes down to morally on that last phone call is simply that he tells him to, child would have died either way, but he does tell him to deliver the message and then run.
Yeah, he is trying to play not only pigeon attendant, but also fire warden, right? So a big part of the Blitz were these incendiary bombs. They were designed so that they don't explode, they just start fires.
Yeah, but you are supposed to feel morally that he should have told the child to run immediately.
Yeah, but again, this is wartime, and actually people watching this movie would have said this kid is even more of a hero because he put out this incendiary bomb that was going to set fire to another building,
yes,
and maybe killed a lot of other
decision.
People.
He doesn't say, go put out the bomb. He says, give me the message and then get out.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that is the moral issue there.
Yeah. And he dies.
That creates the change of heart in Don Amici.
Before that, I mean, he's dead set on revealing this very important state secret to the world, right?
Well, he has a physical fight with Joan Bennett over it.
Yeah, he locks her up.
Well, and also she tries to knock his head off.
Yeah.
And he threatens to knock hers off.
Yeah. He's just as dedicated to the news over all moral considerations as anyone in the front page or His Girl Friday. But the news that Roddy McDowell has died, it dams up the works for him. He's no longer a pure Hoxian professional at that point. And yeah, the movie, I think, does a great job of making you feel the emotional wall up there. Because it has to. Otherwise, there's just no poignancy to the whole thing.
Killing children is not... standard in Hollywood movies. Well, okay, yes, it is, actually, but usually die of some kind of disease. No, they're not killed at the end of a movie this way.
Yeah, and Roddy McDowell is a really likable little guy, right?
Oh, yes.
And it all comes down to this because he started to send the message and they're like, okay, wait a minute, we didn't get that. Can you confirm or deny these stories that you started to tell us about? And instead, he writes up an obituary for this 12-year-old boy who would be completely unsung and unnoticed otherwise.
So presumably the child dying on his watch has brought home for him the fact that real people's lives are at stake.
He also resigns from his job.
Yes.
Because, and I guess he has to, right? Because, and that's probably the most interesting thing about the movie, which is that you can't do this job if you're going to obey national security dictates. So you have to quit, one or the other. Now, I guess in the real world, in December 1941, that character could just go join the American Army or whatever, or join the Secret Service at that point and be an intelligence officer and fight the Nazis because the Americans have entered the war now. That's how they leave the movie. They are rescued from this wine cellar. So it's just Joan Bennett and Don Ameche and the corpse of Arthur Shields in the cellar with a ticking bomb. They are liberated. And that's where the movie closes.
So it seems to be a variant on a familiar type of movie from right about this year, Hollywood movie, which is the realizing that there is a greater good than your bourgeois American values.
Yeah, it's got some commonalities with Casablanca and several other movies of that kind.
Arise, My Love.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, the struggle against fascism. You have to suppress individual glory at times, or your romantic feelings. In this case, no, he can keep his romantic feelings, but not his newspaper star status.
But all that makes it sound pretty pat.
It really isn't. It's a pretty unique little movie, and I don't think it's all that easy to see. But
it does feel like a unique little movie.
Highly recommended. If you can't find it, just let us know, as always. Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto.
So we're just going to do this chronologically?
Yeah.
So Cat on a Hot Tin Roof.
So had you seen this before?
Are you kidding me? Yes, of course.
Okay, I hadn't, right? I hadn't seen this
before. You've never seen this movie?
No. I'm not a Tennessee Williams fan.
It has nothing to do with being a Tennessee Williams fan. This is a movie that played all the time, particularly at holiday times.
Yeah, I avoided it.
Mm. As a child, you knew that you hated Tennessee Williams, as a small child.
Yeah, because I had seen a couple, and I was like, oh, I don't know, it's going to be more Southern plantation people yelling at each other. I don't know if I can deal with this. So it happened to be one that was presented to me after.
There aren't any Tennessee Williams movies about Southern plantation people yelling at each other. There aren't any. That doesn't happen.
Legacy aristocrats of the South yelling at each other.
Okay, one, which is Blanche DuBois.
I just feel like that's what they're all about, or that's what I felt like at the time. And I was like, I'm not going to watch this.
Okay, well, I didn't know anything about Tennessee Williams as a small child, unlike you.
I wasn't a big fan of the 50s stars when I was a kid either. Like, I didn't care about Paul Newman. I didn't care about Elizabeth Taylor. Those were just not stars I cared about.
Well, my uncle cared about those stars, and I'm pretty sure he's the one who roped me into watching this movie once or more than once during holiday times. And I was hypnotized by it because it's obviously a family melodrama where everyone is very nasty to each other and has very bad motivations. And the movie has no subtext, so it is completely open about all of that. Dating to each other what all of their terrible feelings and motivations are the whole time.
And isn't that part of Tennessee Williams' modus operandi?
Sure, pretty much. So I would make correspondences between semi-conscious childhood correspondences between the figures in this movie and my own family. Partly in kind of a nightmare mirror reflection and partly just exaggerated accuracy.
We have several special subjects coming out. Elise's family freakouts.
This yeah, is not. I love that type of genre.
This is not yet on the schedule, but I am definitely pushing for you to put it on a future family freakout, probably from 2036, around there. So we will be talking about it again in some shape or form. It'll get its own real episode.
I want to say the last time I saw this movie was in my 20s at some point. Of the three famous Tennessee Williams movies, well, actually, there's only two famous movies. Of the three famous Tennessee Williams plays, because he only had three, this is considered the least of them.
Well, there's The Glass Menagerie.
And Streetcar in this one.
Yeah.
And then he basically had no other career, which is a shame. So this is considered the least of them. And my favorite, well, I mean, I think the Streetcar movie is great, directed by Kazan, with great performances from Vivian Leigh and Marlon Brando and everybody else. But probably my favorite Tennessee Williams movie is one for which he wrote an original screenplay, also by Kazan, loosely based on a one-act play he wrote, which is Baby Doll. I love that movie, and I do have it, I think, on the schedule somewhere.
It is.
Because it's the movie, it's a Tennessee Williams work that made clear to me that in all of his plays that I'm familiar with, the famous ones, he is a black comedian. It is black comedy that he's writing. He's very funny.
Yeah.
And this movie is no exception.
Jack Carson is terrific in it.
I feel like the direction's a little lacking in this movie, and it is, you know, not one of his great plays. The performances are all astonishing, though.
I really liked it.
Did you?
know, that's the news flash here.
Astonishing. The performances are astonishing, including Elizabeth Taylor.
Everyone is really good. Burl Ives is probably the greatest performance.
But the way Newman and Burl Ives play off against each other?
Yeah, it's really good. It's really good. I mean, we should do a Burl Ives special subject or something, because what an interesting figure. I mean, he played some of these horrifying, domineering patriarchs, but in some cases, not all cases, but in some, like this one, with some very humanizing moments, like when he's recalling his hobo dad. But then he's also kind of very well known as the narrator of Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, right?
But Jack Carson has a great pathos moment. Judith Anderson has a bunch of great pathos moments.
Yeah, you can't fault this movie for acting. Everybody really delivers the goods, including, as you say, Elizabeth Taylor.
So underrated. She has probably the worst voice of any major actress in Hollywood, which she puts to good effect in Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. I can't stand her voice. It's unbearable. But I can't deny that she is very nice to look at and a very, very good actress.
Yeah, my prejudices when I was 12 have evaporated for the most part. I probably wouldn't have liked it when I was 12, but I did really like it this time.
Well, if you out there are hesitant about Tennessee Williams, just realize that he's a sort of dark comedian and maybe everything will fall into place for you. I always loved Tennessee Williams, but everything really, I understood why I loved him after I saw Baby Doll and had that realization.
We'll have more to say about Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. I guess everyone who's ever read anything about the movie would know that they've changed a fair bit.
Oh, I mean, the movie is, and this is something I quite enjoyed as a child, but the movie is so pat in the way they pass through this familial dark night of the soul and come out with hope at the end of it. It's also absolutely absurd. The biological advantage of Paul Newman and Elizabeth Taylor is rewarded at the end of the movie. Just the fact that they're beautiful and intelligent, unlike Jack Carson and his brood.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a real eugenics quality
absolutely.
To it.
But I mean, I don't know, that kind of works as a commentary on Hollywood movies.
I mean, I haven't read it, but I presume it's a lot more forthright about the fact that Paul Newman was in love with his best chum.
I think more forthright. It's been a long time since I read about the play, so I don't know if it was completely forthright. Here we've got a double subtext, as so often in representations of homosexuality up until at least the 60s. There's a text and a subtext that cancel each other out, so nothing ends up making any sense in those terms.
Yeah, because, I mean, Paul Newman is depicted as, you know, freezing Elizabeth Taylor out, doesn't want to have sex with her, but whenever she's not around, I mean, he really wants to have sex with her.
The best you can do with it is say he's bisexual. Like, that's the best you can do.
He nuzzles up to her robe in that bathroom in a very suggestive way. So he's not indifferent to her charms, and he looks at her when she's not looking at him. So he's just not interested in her?
I honestly don't remember.
Okay. Well, we'll leave it at that for now. Maybe we'll read the play before we watch the film next time.
I haven't read the play since I was a teenager.
Palm Beach Story. I mean, this one we don't want to talk about too much at all because we have a full-blown episode on it coming up in May 2023, which is only 6 months away, but an amazing movie.
I think I finally completely came around to it on this viewing.
So fucking good.
It's a really weird movie, and
it sure is.
I didn't instantly take to it the way I did to The Lady Eve, and pretty quickly to Miracle of Morgan's Creek. Really came around this time. There were people enjoying themselves in the audience. That was nice. Although no one was enjoying
Toto
as much as you are. Not even close.
Neats Toto.
Everybody was appreciating Rudy Valley, and I have to say, this is one of the all-time great comic performances in a movie.
I agree with you. He's amazing in this movie. And what a bizarre mid-career change of pace for Rudy Valley. Because, you know, he was the vagabond lover. He was the voice of sex and romance on the radio.
And I still find him, as I've said before and confirmed watching it on the big screen, I still find him pretty sexy in this movie.
Well, yeah, he's a handsome guy.
Well, no, he's not. He's really weird looking. But there's something about him.
He's appealing.
He's appealing.
And it's really weird, too, because you have this movie where he's playing a guy that should be frozen out and not be the love interest, but he's so likable. He is. Mary Astor too, right? She's exactly the kind of character that usually doesn't get the guy.
She's less likable, but somehow she manages...
No, she's very likable.
You love... See, you got a crush on Mary Astor.
Well, of course, I love Mary Astor. I make no secret of this.
Rudy Valley crush, and the thing is too that they are the screwballs, and they are the funny characters, much more than Bodette Colbert and Jill McRae, although they're very enjoyable as always.
Yeah.
But I feel like nobody, and this is also true of Unfaithfully Yours, no actor ever spoke, maybe Stanwyck and the Lady Eve, no male actor ever spoke Strurges' dialogue better than Rudy Valley. His delivery is absolutely perfect of those lines, and they land exactly as they should.
Yeah, and he comes back in a couple of Strurges movies in the late 40s, right? But not in nearly as amazing a role.
No, this is all-time great.
The meta imperatives operating here, and then Strurges just has a blast with it, right? He's like, well, I've created these, you know, other man and other woman that usually have to be discarded at the end of the movie, but I like them, and I'm going to bring some twins in so that they can have Joel McRae and Claudette Colbert too, and everyone is happily ever after.
Even Toto.
Yeah. Claudette Colbert has never looked better than in this movie, too. I mean, they really shot her well.
She looks pretty great. Also, the social commentary in the movie is so sly and complex and interesting.
The Ale and Quail Club are basically, you know, the Republican National Convention.
People were laughing so hard at all of the gun stuff.
Sociopathic violence of these millionaires. I mean...
It still makes you wonder how it did and how it would play to an audience who was sympathetic to them. I don't know how you could be sympathetic.
No, these are monsters.
How could you be sympathetic? It's not possible.
Absolute monsters.
Not the craziest gun nut on the planet. Like, even they would have to recognize that they were being satirized. They'd have to.
And it's pretty funny that William Demarest is playing a character called Bill Docker again. He had just played a Bill Docker in Christmas in July. Anyway, we should probably stop there because we'll talk about this movie in full.
And we have one more. So did you actually look up Bodil Ipsen, who was this famous charismatic stage performer and then film performer before she started directing? She is not a great beauty. It's one of those interesting cases.
Well, she's certainly someone I'm interested in exploring now because this movie was quite interesting and I just picked it because they're doing a Nordic noir series. We didn't really have time on our schedule to see more than one, but we picked one and I wanted to get the one that's from the actual noir period of the 40s. It was made in Denmark in 1944 under Nazi occupation.
Wait a minute, Ipsen?
Ipsen, yeah.
Oh, I thought it was Ibsen. No, it's Ipsen. Anyway, so apparently she played Rosalind in As You Like It, Nora in A Doll's House, Lady Macbeth, Miss Julie. So she must have had a lot of sexual charisma on the stage that photography is not capturing.
Yeah, well, they named the acting awards in Denmark after her, apparently.
This movie did not blow me away, but based on the way the introducer was talking about her, she did direct quite a lot of movies. I've never heard of her before. This is yet another actress to director, early female director we never had no idea about. It was definitely interesting enough, the movie, to make me want to see more.
Yeah, I really do. And hopefully we can get a hold of some with subtitles, right? Because that is one of the great things about The Lightbox, which is that apparently there were no subtitles for this movie, and they made them for this screening.
Oh, so there might not be anything else available to see with subtitles.
We'll have to look into it. But if there are, we'll make a special subject for
maybe
her, for sure.
Maybe someone will do a retrospective.
Well, they could. Yeah, you'd nice. Think they would, if the movies are in shape to be shown.
Well,
we'll
this
look
one
into
was,
it.
This one was in perfect shape.
It looked great. Yeah, I thought it was a really good experience. No, I don't think it's one of the great movies I've ever seen, but I was really engaged by it, and I liked the lead actress a lot.
Who is?
Gulmaj Norin was really interesting, and she had a tough role, because she is a definite murder suspect, let's say, but she's also our protagonist. And it's not like Victor Mature in I Wake Up Screaming, where we kind of know he didn't do it. In this movie, you kind of think she did, although there might be extenuating circumstances that we won't get into too much.
And her ex-husband, who also plays an important role in all of this.
What a weirdo.
Well, he's still her husband, but they're not living together anymore. He definitely reminded me of Jules Berry in Daybreak.
A little bit less charismatic.
Well, I don't know how charismatic Jules Berry is in that movie, but the difference is that Jules Berry looks like the picture, and is, in fact, the picture of sanity in Daybreak compared to this guy. Jules Berry's character is just an ordinary cabaret performer with a sadistic streak.
Yeah, this guy...
This guy is in another dimension.
Yeah, he's really nasty. You just can't even imagine how creepy he's gonna get by the end of this movie. Again, this is early in the noir cycle worldwide, and nobody was seeing American movies in Denmark in 1944. They were under Nazi occupation. So some of the camera stuff going on here, I guess they could have been hearkening back as well to German Expressionism. I mean,
Would they have been seeing French films? Could they have seen poetic... Well, they would have seen poetic realism films.
They would have seen those before the war.
Yeah,
sure.
Before the war.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Anyway, really interesting movie. Check it out. Next week on the podcast, it is our November special subject, the Noirvember Cirque.
So more noir, even more noir.
We'll be watching four movies, four big features next week. Lured, Sleep, My Love, Shockproof, written by Samuel Fuller.
Not recommended by him.
And Thunder on the Hill. Looking forward to that. We spent some time with Cirque in the 30s in Germany. Let's catch up with them in Hollywood in the 1940s.
See you then.